Okay, hello and welcome everyone to today's event. I'm Jason Gumpert from MSDynamicsWorld.com, and I am joined today by Garth Laird and Dan Edwards of Zap for a session on the real challenges of BI and analytics and how you can trust your data. As we get started, please know that we do welcome you to add your feedback and ask questions using the Q&A block that you should see to the right of the main presentation window. You can enter your questions anytime. Garth and Dan will be leaving a time at the end to take questions. So without further delay, let's get things started, and please allow me to welcome Garth Laird from Zap.
Thanks, Jason. Welcome to all on the webcast today, whether it's good morning, good afternoon, or for some of you in Europe, good evening. Thanks for joining us. As Jason said, my name's Garth Laird. I look after the commercial operations globally for Zap. Joining with me today is Dan Edwards, who is our lead for all things Dynamics in the business, and both of us are based out of the west coast of the United States. By way of introduction, we are a global business that has been selling to the Dynamics space for many, many years. We have customers across all variants of Dynamics, whether that be AX, CRM, NAV, GP, etc. And so we've got hundreds of thousands of users through, I think, now over 40 countries. And we believe we have some sort of level of knowledge to be able to talk through some of the subjects here and assist you with some of the pitfalls and things to consider around BI in general. One of the things that comes out of that, of course, is Dynamics as a group of products is servicing a wide range of customers. You know, we have a number of people on the call today that will vary from small and mid-market organizations that might be servicing one type of product into one geography, right up to the largest of multinationals that have got multiple deployments of a Dynamics product, including legacy data, data from the cloud, multinational business with billions of revenue and thousands of products and services. And of course, that means that your life cycle around BI might be slightly different. And we see that a lot depending on the Dynamics product, and depending on the size of the organization and the complexity. Some organizations may have one person assigned to all things IT, and other people we're dealing with have an entire department of analysts and BI experts trying to model data into what is a repeatable stream of information for the business. The one thing that is consistent, though, that is becoming very obvious as BI becomes a bigger and bigger focus for all businesses, is that it is all about the data. What we've seen over the years is BI really started as most things have started in the enterprise software industry. It started with larger players like Cognos and Business Objects and Hyperion and MicroStrategy. And those products have been around for many, many years and sort of older now and very well entrenched in larger customers. But what had happened over the last 5 or 6 years particularly is there's been a massive explosion in data. And I know you all see that in your personal lives, and we certainly see it in our business lives. And with that explosion of data, meant people were looking for new ways to analyze data quickly. There was all sorts of desire to try and get hold of data and make it a bigger and more important asset in the business to be more competitive. So with that, there was the start and the opportunity for companies like ClickTech and Tableau and Tipico Spotfire, and now, of course, Power BI, as really excellent self-service products to come to market and provide the ability to download a solution, connect it to a data source, and hopefully within 24, 48 hours start to be seeing some data that was meaningful to a part of the business. And there's no doubt that that has been an extremely successful trend and has actually facilitated some wonderful outcomes for many, many organizations across the world and will continue to do so. But as that started to become quite prevalent, what's also started to happen is people realize that it really is all about the data. You know, the fact that you've got a very nice, good-looking presentation tool that has nice dashboards and KPIs and reporting is not necessarily directly related to the information that's coming out as 100% valid. And so it really has become all about the data, and people realize now that the data quality issues and the data management issues are the things that really matter around a good BI strategy. And, you know, putting it, given the fact this is a Dynamics audience, putting it really in quite distinct terms, for many years the Dynamics business based out of Seattle was a separate business to Microsoft insofar as it was sort of run separately. And here we are only a few weeks ago now understanding that the Dynamics business is actually managed out of the Power BI business. And I think that is pretty indicative of a good understanding of where Microsoft sees all of this going, where for many years, you know, literally 20, 30 years, the Microsoft Business Solutions products, or Dynamics as it's called, had been created by previous businesses then bought by Microsoft. So the supply chain management, manufacturing, distribution, finance, Salesforce automation solutions that Dynamics cover have been around for many, many years. But where we're going now, I think everybody sees that it's all going to be about the data that comes out of these solutions. So even though everybody needs good process control around what Dynamics offers, I think Microsoft sees it's going to be the outcomes and the insights that is created by those solutions into the future that is what people are going to be looking for. So really interesting to see that change. So as a result of all that, even though self-service through products like Power BI and Tableau and the like can be incredibly helpful and really easy to self-help from a data source or series of data sources, it doesn't always come with a lot of self-control. In fact, it probably comes with no self-control at all. And that has become really quite a big issue for medium-sized and larger businesses who are trying to rely on the data to make informative decisions around their business. And so, therefore, the importance of data intelligence, as we call it here in ZAP, where you have the ability to have a product that can automate the integration to data sources, and then the ability also to model those data sources into repeatable models that the business can use through enterprise BI tools or self-service BI tools, becomes very much the crux of the entire BI solution and strategy, and it really becomes the engine room to which a repeatable BI strategy that you can rely upon is something that you can take out to market. So from a corporate point of view, to be able to have an entire data automation and data modeling intelligent data platform becomes really the most important thing to do, and then you can then determine what visualization capabilities you might want on top of that. And for those of you on the call who are actually involved in the BI part of an organization, it also becomes a very much a personal win-win, because you can get data out to the business more frequently in a more reliable way, and you can be seen as the person in the organization that's delivering that value, and it becomes very much a personal win as well as a corporate win. Now, you might well ask, why have I got this these series of pictures on the right-hand side? As you probably noticed, that's an Audi R8, which is a beautiful motor vehicle. Right from up the top, where you've got the running gear, the chassis and the body, all of that comes together to, obviously, on the bottom there, that beautiful-looking car. But inside that car is a gearbox made by a company called ZF, and all Audis use that gearbox. And that really is the engine room to make that a repeatable, consistent experience for people who are driving that car, because that is the crux, as I said, of that vehicle. We see data automation and data modeling, or as we call it, data intelligence, as really the gearbox of the BI solution. Without it, you've got something that really does look very good, but you can't rely on it at any point of time. And that's, I think, a very good way to think about what Dan is about to show you in respect to the different ways you can interrogate data and the importance of having a data intelligence solution. Now, another way to look at that is through a concept we call centricity. And centricity really is just what I've said, but put into four pillars. You need to be able to discover your data, and you need to do that in a uniform way that actually creates a single data hub to which the whole organization can get access. That data hub needs to then have data models that actually create a model of data that is consistent, repeatable, managed by the business as well as IT, so that whether or not you've got 10, 15, 20, 100, or 1,000 people interrogating that data model, and whether or not they are slicing and dicing in different ways, they still are using the same data to come up with the same result. That means you can then visualize that using any tool. It does not matter at that point whether it's Zap BI, whether it's Tableau, whether it's Power BI or ClickTech. You're actually doing it off a platform that is governed. And finally, that governance then allows you to be confident that you're delivering out to the business something that you can be proud of, and also something that decisions can be made on and relied upon. Another way to look at that in the next slide would be just to look at it from left to right, where the power that you need, and when you think about it, lots of organizations we deal with now have lots of legacy data. You've got your current systems of record, whether that be your current CRM or ERP products. And then also now, more often than not, we've got people trying to bring in all sorts of on-premise or cloud data in addition to that, whether it be best practice, trending information, whether it be budgeting and forecasting. There's all sorts of other data people are trying to bring together. We have a solution called Data Intelligence that brings that all together in the ability to have data automation and data modeling, as I've said. And then on the right-hand side, just by way of example, Power BI can then be used to visualize all of that in a repeatable way that you as an organization and you as BI professionals can rely upon. So finally, I think before I hand across to Dan, it's always really very good to have a series of things that as professionals in the industry we can rely on as third parties supporting what we say. It's easy for Dan and I to sort of talk to you today about what we think. And we're pretty ardent and strong about our beliefs in this area because we've seen so many customers with the problems that we overcome. But it's always good to have some third-party validation. So Joe Mundy from the Kimball Group in an article called Leverage Data Visualization Tools But Avoid Anarchy has said lately, the crucial decision facing organizations planning BI implementation, including self-service data discovery and visualization tools, is whether or not they will lay a platform for success by basing self-service on a strongly governed data management strategy. Now that hopefully sums up exactly what I've just said in the preceding slides. The next quote is also very interesting from a very well-known individual called, Gartner, which of course is very well-known. Through 2017, less than 40% of self-service BI initiatives will be governed sufficiently to prevent inconsistencies that adversely affect the business. That article only just came out this month. And that just shows you the huge risk that so many organizations who are deploying self-service BI tools without properly governed managed data intelligence solutions can get themselves into. And then finally, Jen Underwood, who's very well known around the Microsoft stack for her work in the Microsoft Business Intelligence area, said in an article, when misused or improperly rolled out, self-service BI initiatives can quickly create an expensive data mess to fix that is not immediately apparent to non-technical business users. Now, two things there. The biggest issue with that is it's not immediately apparent. And we have had a number of customers come to us who have rolled out a strategy that has been in place for 15, 18, 20 months, and all of a sudden they've realized that the data they've been relying upon to make some very critical business decisions was wrong, was incorrect, and created a foundation to which there was a very large cost to the business. That had become a very big personal issue for those that we were working with, clearly a corporate issue. So that's something to think about. But the other thing which allows me to sort of introduce Dan is an expensive data mess. So with that, I'm going to introduce Dan Edwards, who will take over and run the balance of the presentation, and then we'll be back for questions later on. Thanks, Dan.
Thank you, Garth, and thanks to Jason and the team and everybody for joining us today. And I think Garth, you know, kind of set our stage very well, you know, and talked about, you know, the possible data mess that some of you might be seeing as you're trying to approach that data. And, you know, one of the keys is, you know, looking at what's out in the marketplace today. So I just returned actually late last night from the Microsoft Insight Summit, which was their Power BI and Excel conference. And I found it very interesting sitting through the keynote. They showed many demos with very different approaches to visualization, including introducing a new visualization called Sandance. While it looked very, very nice on the screen, what they never talked about is where did the information that was visualized on the screen come from. So, you know, I like to put that together here in this iceberg that I'm looking at, and, you know, that top layer, that what we see above the water of the iceberg, you know, might look very pretty, and, you know, it might be there in Tableau or Power BI or Zap or any of the different visualizations, but, you know, just like with an iceberg, 90% of business intelligence is actually under the water or underneath the hood. And what makes up that piece that's under the water? Well, as Garth mentioned, you've got your legacy systems, you've got ERP, you've got CRM, you've got your different business systems. Then you need to have data automation to bring all those pieces together and model that data to return it in a way that visualization is actually going to work and produce the right visual that people are looking for. And then make sure that information is correct and properly governed. Nothing worse than having two different executives looking at dashboards they've created, both making decisions on those sales numbers, but to find out that they're looking at the wrong number, or, you know, one's looking at one way and one's looking at it another way. So, you know, really needing to bring all this data intelligence together and making sure the visualizations are correct. So without that foundation underneath, you know, the iceberg's going to crumble. So as Garth mentioned, big data, there's lots of data around. It's coming at us from many different directions, whether it's coming from our ERP systems like Dynamics or whether it's coming from other sources, everything from your email to other SQL databases, et cetera. So, you know, how do you bring all this together and how do you work with this and keep it easy and governed and let those self-service users pull all this information together? Well, you know, over the years, I've done a lot of work in the business intelligence and reporting arena, and, you know, I've really found that, you know, there's about three different ways that we can connect to data nowadays. You know, one is to go directly to the tables. Another is a fairly new approach, and one we're hearing a lot around Dynamics, is OData connections. You know, Power BI uses a lot of that. And then there's, you know, data warehousing, data modeling that we're very familiar with. So what I want to do in the presentation today is actually take a look at those different approaches, look at some of the self-service tools, and see how things would work, you know, going direct to the table, how things work with OData, maybe what some of the issues you might run into as you're working with that. So let me switch out a PowerPoint and see if I can switch into my demo environment. So what I have here is I'm actually running Tableau. So what I'm going to do with Tableau is actually go ahead and connect to my AX server. So I'm going to go ahead and put that information in. And it's going to go ahead and allow me to choose which database I want to work with. So I'm actually going to go direct to the Microsoft Dynamics AX database. You know, I'm logged in. I have it knew my authentication, so I have security to get to the AX database. And for, you know, those of you that work with AX, you may be aware there's about 6,000 tables out there. So now it's rendering me that list of tables. And my background's accounting, so I don't really know all those table names, but I do happen to know I want to get some travel information and things like that. So I'm going to go ahead and try and filter this down. Let's go ahead and look for the travel expense tables. So I'm going to find those here, hopefully. Travel expense, there it is. So the travel expense table, I'm going to go ahead and select that. And then I know I need the transactions to go along with that. So I've selected both of those, and, you know, Tableau's trying to help me out. It's actually done a join between those two tables. But if I go ahead and update the data, you know, I start, oh, all the posting dates are 1/1/90, and I'm not seeing customer accounts. I'm just, yeah, it doesn't look like really good data. Well, what I happen to know is that's not the proper way to connect these tables. So, again, I have to know a little bit about the database here and know that it's the rec ID that actually connects to the travel expense table. So now I'm going to go ahead and change that. Now update my data. Okay, that looks a little better. So now I'm able to bring in some information and see what's available in that. So from here, I'm going to go ahead and jump out to my design. And now the problem I see here over on the right-hand side, again, I'm getting just those SQL names, but unfortunately I've worked with AX for quite a while, so I do know I want the account master, so I'm going to go ahead and pull that up onto my report, and then I'm going to go ahead and look at this by merchant ID and go ahead and bring that out, and sure enough there I'm able to return some information and then go ahead and maybe put this into a chart. So I can pull that information out going direct to table, but, you know, you could certainly see if I didn't know how to properly link this information and if I didn't understand maybe all these field names, I wouldn't be able to bring that on. You know, in a matter of fact, if I wanted to look at this by department or something like that, I'm not even seeing the field name to do that. So I would need to find, you know, some additional information. So not, you know, that's just using Tableau. I'm not, Tableau is the way to connect. There's other ways I could have used Tableau. So again, it's nothing against the self-service tool. It's just the way to connect there, you know, didn't really pull what I want. So I'm going to go out and go with Power BI this time. So I'm going to go into Power BI and start with getting my data. And I'm going to use the OData connection. So I'm going to go ahead and scroll down here. I can never find it. I'll just type it in. OData. There we go. So I need an OData feed. So I'm going to go ahead and make that connection. Now the OData feed, I'm not going to get into how to set that up in AX, but you know that's one of the custom queries you can set up inside of AX. So I'm going to go ahead, I've got it saved over here on another screen. I'm going to just paste in that URL for the OData feed. Again, looking at my expense report, so I'm going to look at the same information that I was looking at direct to table using Tableau. So let's go ahead and let it read that information in. So it's making that connection out to AX. And there we go. And, you know, I'm seeing kind of the same information that I was seeing before. But again, I'm going to go into edit mode so I can actually maybe clean up this query. So if I go into columns, I can go in and maybe deselect all of them because I don't need so many columns. And let's just go ahead and take the destination, the expense number, and then you know, maybe scroll down here to the transactions, get the amount, get the approval status. So you know, it's going to take a minute or two here to make sure I pull in the right information. But you know, able to do that, I don't have to worry about the join like I had to worry about going with direct to data because that join was already taken care of by the query in OData. So I've already got the join. I know that's all correct. So let me go ahead and make sure I've got that merchant ID. I'm going to get a couple more here, maybe the payment method. Well, transaction date's always relevant. So I think I've got that. And then maybe let's bring in the business unit and the cost center. So I'm going to go ahead and apply that. And you know, the modeling capabilities, the query capabilities in Power BI fix that up for me real quick. As a matter of fact, I can even come into these headers here and actually rename the header if I wanted to do that. I think actually I just double click in there. There we go. Just double click in there and you know, I can rename that destination. I could go through and rename all of those, but for sake of time, I'm just going to go ahead and apply. So now it's going to apply those query changes. And now I'm going to be able to do some design work here in Power BI. So let's let that data model go ahead and build out. And again, still had to understand a little bit about the data because it was bringing in, you know, TRV expense table, things like that. So now if I look over here on my field, so I'll just kind of widen that. I'm going to go ahead and grab my account or amount master, and then I looked at it by merchant there in Tableau. So let's do the same thing here in Power BI. So, you know, there I'm able to get that same type of information that I was able to do direct to table, but now I did it through OData. And it, since the OData actually brought in the business units and the cost centers, let's see if I can expand on that. So I'm going to go ahead and grab by business unit so I can bring in some additional information there. Now I'm only getting the business unit number. Unfortunately, it doesn't look like I have the business unit name available through OData. So again, we would have to find that OData query back in AX and bring that information together into that. So let's look at a third approach. Let's look at going more to a data model truly designed to do this expense reporting. So I'm going to go ahead and just start Power BI over again real quick. So let's just take a moment to launch for us. And again, as we're going through here, please be sure if you have any questions, Jason's monitoring that question pane for us. Go ahead and enter those. So I'm going to go ahead and select to get the data. And I'm going to go out and connect to my data model. So I've got that on this same server. So I'm going to go ahead and I can connect it live to this data model. This is one of the features Power BI and many of the self-service tools allow us to do. And I have a model out here for my expense reports that I built with Zap Data Intelligence. And, you know, it tells me here it's bringing in business units and expense lines and expense reports. So I'm going to go ahead and make that connection. And now if I look over here on the right-hand side, you know, first thing I see, you know, again, I'm seeing some plain English information. And so I want my measures, my expense lines. So I don't have several choices there like I might have had before. Simply want to go ahead and pull in the amount. And then I want to pull in the merchant information there on the expense lines. There's my merchant ID. So without having to do any renaming, without having to do any modeling in Power BI or Tableau or anything like that, I was able to quickly recreate that amount by merchant chart. Now, let's go ahead and continue on because it looks like this data model might have some additional information that we weren't able to get out of direct to table or out of the OData. So now if I look at amount, you know, maybe I want to look at that amount by business unit, and it looks like I can actually get the business unit name. So now instead of just seeing the numbers, I'm seeing the business unit name. So, you know, now one thing nice with Power BI, you know, I highlight over the management consulting practice, and it quickly highlights and identifies the amount by merchant so I can see where we're spending our money on management consulting practice versus whole. So again, this is allowing me a lot more flexibility. Maybe I want to look at amount by category description. So, and then I have, again, many different visualizations. Now I'm at the, you know, top of the iceberg now that I've got that data model built underneath that. So I can start quickly designing these without worrying about how calculations are done, how are these relationships done, anything like that. So how was this data model created? I'm just going to close a couple screens and just give you an example of what we do with a tool like Zap Data Intelligence. Just going to go ahead and open this tool up. And what you'll find here is that I have the ability to go into a modeling tool that actually understands the AX environment and can bring in AX 2009, 2012, CRM, other dynamic solutions. I don't actually have NAV and GP and those loaded in this environment, but we have solutions for that, as well as other data sources. And then we can actually manage pipelines to bring that data in. So it gives you a central repository to bring all that information together and manage that data. So let me go ahead and see if I can bring back up my slides, maybe talk about some summary information that we've talked about there. So, you know, direct to table, what did we see there when I was in Tableau? That with direct to table, you know, it really required an understanding of the database. First of all, I had to know what table names I wanted to go out with. They weren't just simply called expense report. They were called, you know, TRV EXP table and TRV EXP trans. So I had to know that. And then Tableau, Power BI, neither one of them know relationships. So it guessed and it tried to actually relate it on the approval when it actually needed to relate it on a rec ID. So, you know, can we work with direct table? You certainly can, but it's going to require some technical, not typically a self-service user. OData, again, it requires us to set that up in Dynamics to start with, and that then takes care of the relationship. But typically a lot of the OData feeds bring in additional information you may not need. So there were many columns I had to delete, yet it didn't bring in the department name and the business unit name and things like that. It just simply brought in the code number. So again, I have to refine that query inside of Dynamics. where a true data automation or data modeling tool allows true governance. It gives us the friendly names. It only shows the fields that we want our self-service users to work with. So now they're getting a consistent view of the data. If they do that relationship wrong in the direct to table, they may get a report that shows expense reports, but it may not show the right amount on those expense reports. They wouldn't necessarily know that if they don't know detailed information about the data. So this is just a quick highlight. You know, we didn't want to run real long on this. We just wanted to show you, you know, some different ways you can approach this. Jason, let me pause here. Are there any questions on anything I covered at this point?
All right, thanks, thanks, Dan. And yep, if you do have any questions, please enter them into the Q&A section to the right of the main presentation window. We'd be happy to take those now. Let me take a look here. So one question, we are a mid-market business in retail, and this has been helpful as we have a lot of data. How do we get a demo of the product, and how is it priced?
Jason, I'm happy to take that. It's Garth Laird again. You certainly, we can arrange after this for any demonstrations of the product. I think the important thing is the way our data intelligence product and our ZAPPI product is priced is we do have customers from, you know, as I said early on, from much smaller Dynamics customers up to some of the very largest. So we now have pricing models that allow people to get an investment into Zap at a very low price point from a subscription point of view, as well as those who are wanting to invest for more of a long term and a perpetual license as well. So we have a combination of different pricing strategies. Our products are componentized, so you can actually buy parts of what you need and then add on to them later, and we're very happy to discuss all of that.
All right. So next question, with only two people in IT, can we use this type of solution easily so that it reduces the burden of writing reports for the business?
And I think that's a great question, because I think that really sums up what we're, you know, what Dan's done a great job in showing is that if we used part of the example that Dan showed in the presentation, you get to a product like Dynamics AX, all the ERP products these days are complex, and you add a whole range of other solutions to that, and you end up with a lot of table structures, a lot of joins, a lot of things you need to do to make the data you need to get to the business quite a complicated exercise. With two people in IT, the whole idea of data automation and data modeling through our solution is to make sure that you have a tool that you can easily be trained on, you can use, you can create a platform for your business, and then the business can use self-service tools so they can do their own reporting, and you done the part you need to do as IT to make sure the data structures are delivering out the value, and you can do that in a productized way rather than having to spend literally months and months building things and forever be changing those builds without any real documentation, without any real control. So that's the whole idea of this, is to have a very well-priced and cost-effective modeling and automation tool that can make people in IT look very, very strong in what they're doing to the front-end business who needs reliable data.
Garth, and one thing I'd like to add to that is also our knowledge of the Dynamics solution, and that we have a quick start for any of the Dynamics applications so that the IT team can simply deploy that quick start and be well on their way and not having to build all these step by step.
Yeah, very good point, Garth. Very good point.
Great, and I want to make a last call for questions here. We do have one more. But if you do have any of your own, please do get them in now. I also want to remind folks that we do have a survey after the event, so please be on the lookout for that later on. So the last question, I'm going to paraphrase it here, but it's really asking, I guess, about certification programs and training for new users. Do you have any formal programs like that that you can talk about?
Dan, do you want to take that one?
Yeah, sure. I'll be happy to. I wasn't sure if you were going to go or not, Garth. So as far as training and certification, I mean, definitely training is a key for any tool like this. So we offer training for any of our end users. We have different layers of that training. So we start with a basic modeling training course that walks them through how to complete that modeling solution. And it's actually such a user-friendly solution. That training course is a 12-hour course, and we run it via remote access, so GoToMeeting. So it's a 3 hours a day for 4 days through that training course. And then we have a professional services team that will mentor with you to take you to the next step. We're looking in the future of bringing out some true certifications. At this point, we don't have testing into that because every organization is different. So the key pieces you need, we want to focus on that. But we definitely have online training and instructor-led for you to work with.
All right. Well, that is the last question in our queue right now, so I think we'll start wrapping up. Okay. So, Garth, Dan, thanks so much for joining us today.
Thank you, Jason.
Great. Okay, yeah, and there's your contact information. Thanks, everyone in the audience, for your attention, for your great questions. We really appreciate it. We have recorded today's event, and we'll be making that available. Please be on the lookout for an email alert when that is ready in the next day or two. And with that, we are going to wrap up. Thanks again, everyone, and have a great day.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.